Happy Wednesday, kittens. It is March 8th, 2017, and this is Knot A Podcast episode 176. Welcome, and thank you both new and returning viewers. I am your host, Amanda. You can find me as Wit on Ravelry or as So Nitpicky on Instagram and on YouTube. I blog over at sonitpicky.net, and you can find the Knot A Podcast group on Ravelry if you would like to come in there and chat and participate when we do craft-alongs. I am also the dyer for Lammy Toes, which is lammytoeshop.etsy.com, and I have a dog down here who suddenly is very curious about what I'm doing. So we are in an odd location again, which means just one thing. All of my normal locations have really poor lighting right now. Today has been an odd day. I wasn't sure if I was going to record or not. And I decided to do it anyway because I would like to try to get this edited and up tonight and stay as close as I can to a bi-weekly schedule. So, not a ton going on. Today is International Women's Day, so happy Women's Day to all of my women out there. Let's see, today is also the day after my anniversary. Yesterday was my and my husband's 14th wedding anniversary. We spent it running errands, getting him ready to leave today. I dropped him off this morning. He is currently in holding. They might finally be in transit to the airport and getting ready to fly over to Germany. So, yeah, it's been a very long day, and it was full of even more errands, trying to make sure he was ready to go, getting him to where he needed to be. And then when I got home, I just didn't feel like doing much of anything. So, it's been kind of a lazy day for me today. But I think that's really it for now. There's not a lot going on in my life at the moment. It's just my whole life for the last 2 weeks since I last talked to you guys has really just been preparing for the deployment and putting off preparing for the deployment. You might hear some noise in the background here. I'm recording later than usual, and both of my children have come home. In different sections of the podcast, you're going to notice things like doors opening and stuff happening. Hopefully it will be minimal. My daughter is currently in the bathroom, and she likes to sing when she's in there, so it'll be just a moment, and hopefully she'll just come in and out, and she'll walk quickly. So let's get right down into the podcast today. I have a large finished object to show you guys, a good amount of progress on two works in progress, and I even have some spinning. Those of you who follow me on Instagram already know that, and know that for the first time since October, I actually spun some yarn. Other than that, I'm thinking there's one thing I forgot to talk to you about last week with acquisitions. I hope you can't hear that because she's not even singing for real. She's doing really weird fake singing at the moment where she's trying to sound as bad as possible. So anyway, let's get down into the shall we. First, because I wasn't sure if I was going to record today or not, I did a couple segments with my big finished object for today. Okay guys, so I'm kind of far away from the camera right now, but I wanted to show you how the sweater fits on so that you can see it has been blocked. Most of the ends are woven in. And as you can see, the sweater fits. It actually turned out pretty well. I could have maybe made it just a touch longer, but really this is about where I wanted it to go. The ribbing is laying down flat, and you guys will see more details about the sweater in the rest of the video, but you know, here it is. Not a super good video of it. Okay, sorry for the horrible other video. It's very hard to get long distance shots, to get a picture of a full length knit on the iPhone, and I don't have a regular camera at this point. So I thought I would talk about this pattern for just a second. This podcast is obviously going to be rather fragmented today because I'm hoping you guys can't hear the gusting winds in the background, but it has not been an ideal day for recording. And I decided to at least get this part done so that I can put this sweater away. So this is the Manly Maze sweater by Celeste Culpepper. It is not available for individual purchase. It is in a book called No Sheep for You, which I think Amy Singer of Knitty is put down as the author of the book, although I think she's more the patterns curator and she might have a pattern or two in there, but it's a collection from many different pattern writers. And these were patterns that were written for non-wool yarns. They're all written for cotton or linen or hemp or acrylic blends. So this sweater was knit, just a second. So this sweater was knit almost entirely in Barocco Vintage, which is a, what is it? It's a 52% acrylic, 40% wool, 8% nylon blend from Barocco. It's a worsted weight coming in at about 218 yards for 100 meters. And this is color 5105, but if you look for it in other stores or on stores and at their website, they will call it Oats. I ended up using just over five full skeins of this. I barely broke into the sixth skein. Puppy, this is not the time. Oh my goodness. I barely broke into the sixth skein. I think I used about 10 or 15 grams of it. So overall, it turned out really well. I did do some modifications to the pattern. It's a pretty straightforward, basic raglan men's sweater. This pattern is written for men, thus why it's called the Manly Maze. But I have found that it works pretty well for me too, because in terms of width, I definitely need it, and then I just shorten stuff as necessary. But because this pattern is written for approximately sport weight yarn, and I was using worsted weight yarn, I decided to take a chance with knitting it on size 8 needles and knitting the smallest size, which is a size 36, to get something that's approximately 43 to 44 inches wide. And as you can see, I seem to have succeeded pretty well. This sweater fits me way better than I was expecting, to be honest. I wasn't expecting to like it or be super thrilled with it. The other yarn here that is used for the yoke details, do you like how up close and personal we're getting here? This is some of my hand spun that I did during, I think it was Spinzilla. I knit this out of leftovers from the yarn I spun for the Sowerby shawl. Sowerby is a paid for pattern that my friend Annika Baranti wrote, and you can find it on Ravelry. I think it's a $5 downloadable pattern. She was very kind and gifted it to me, and you've seen that in the past. You saw that during, I think, one of my other odd podcasts like this, where I decided to take a strange stance. And I had a good amount of that yarn left over. I have 5 Hello Yarn patchwork kits, which are 1-pound collections of random fibers, and I ended up making a 1-pound spin out of that, where I just took all of the ones with the same aquas and berry colors and similar greens in them and spun them all up into a 2 massive fluffy skeins, I think. Yeah, or was it 3? I think it was 3 massive fluffy skeins. And overall, I'm really happy with how that yarn turned out, and I think it actually ended up working pretty well for the yoke here. I didn't want something super high contrast this time. I just wanted something pretty and to use up something that I already had on hand. I did have a ballerina pink color of more of this vintage, but I wasn't sure that I had enough to knit with. And having seen how much I ended up using for this, I think I could have gotten away with it had I wanted to. So lesson learned there, I actually probably had just barely enough, then I would have just eked it out and been happy with having used up that partial. Overall, I'm happy with this pattern. I have knit it once before. I knit it a very long time ago, after the book came out. The book came out in 2007, and I think I knit a sweater in the late fall of the winter of that year, and it was supposed to be for my husband, and it didn't quite turn out. I didn't make the sleeves nearly long enough, and I probably could have made the body longer, and I probably could have made it slightly roomier, because it turns out, in general, men like more room in their sweaters than women do, depending on how. This one, like I said, it's a close fit. It's definitely not a 4 inches positive ease kind of a sweater, but it's definitely a pretty close fitting. I'd say it's got about 2 inches of positive ease all the way around. So yeah, overall, I think it's a success, and it's a large amount of yarn out and stash out for me, so it's a big stash win for me. And yeah, I'm happy to have it done. I just have a few more ends on the inside here to weave in, but I got most of the noticeable ones taken care of before I decided to record here. Yeah, see, can you hear that window rattling? It's really windy up there. yeah, so I think that's all I really have to say about this one. I guess too, I could note, because I mentioned I had modified. So the pattern as written calls for the raglan increases to be done, I think, with yarn over raglan increases. Or no, not that. That's not that. It's make one front and backs. But I did make one left and rights instead of that, because I like how they look much better than the bar for the make one front and backs. I did the neck ribbing on a size smaller needle on size 7s, and then I did a tubular bind off. And you can see right here where I had to flip the stitches to get it into 1x1 rib to do the tubular bind off, and you can see the tubular bind off goes all the way around, and so it gives a really nice slick finish, and it's very nice and stretchy. However, I discovered it wasn't stretchy enough to get up my forearms, because my forearms are considerably wider than my wrist, and very soon after. So on the cuffs, I took out the maze patterning And then I did 2x2 ribbing and bound off with what I believe is a Russian bind off, where you knit two, then knit those two stitches together through the back loop, knit another, knit those two stitches together through the back loop, and it gives a nice stretchy cuff. And it's fairly clean looking. You know, it's not as slick as this, but it works. And then on the bottom of this sweater, I knit a little bit of 3x1 ribbing, because in all honesty, I do not like my sweaters coming back in and tugging down or snugging in on the bottom of my body. I like them just to lay loose. So I wanted this to lay flat, so I knit about, I think it's about 1.5 inches of ribbing, and then I did another Russian bind off on that part. And it works just fine. I mean, it's it is definitely not a harmonious overall look to the sweater, but it was meant to be a utilitarian sweater, so it's going to work out just fine. We're getting a little late in the season now for me to need a sweater like this in this house, but for next winter, which is hopefully our last winter here, it should be a very nice choice for a large part of the days between late November through about this time of the year when it gets exceptionally cold and the house is very drafty. It'll help keep me pretty toasty. Like right now, I'm actually almost too warm in this, even though I have only a t-shirt on underneath. So, as you can see, I finished that sweater. That was my big thing I wanted to finish. As I think I've stated before on the podcast a couple of times, one of my big goals this year is to try to knit out a large portion of my sweater stash, because I have discovered that I have lacking amounts of sweater set or amounts of yarn per sweater lot. And a lot of times they're in colors that I don't particularly care to wear as sweaters anymore. So I kind of need to either use them or get rid of them. And I really hate destashing yarn if I don't have to. Because I'm sure most of us know the pain of trying to get something destashed and trying to get a decent price for it for the amount of effort that's going to go into moving it. I do actually have some sock yarn stashed that I would like to try to destash, and I've been debating what the best way to do that is. So, if people like variegated sock yarn, there might be something for you in either my Instagram feed or just in my stash pages on Ravelry. Go have a look. Little plug. Okay, so the next thing I will talk to you about is works in progress. We are over here. You're on my sewing table at the moment. This is a different angle than you usually see. This is my second set of shelves here, and I have one of those IKEA units that was the Expedite series before they discontinued it, and it's one with a big Expedite desk off of a unit, and then I have a second unit stacked on top of it. So this is like sewing stuff mostly over here, although there's also fiber and yarn hiding. Okay, so the next thing I worked on, let's talk about my husband's sock. So as you guys know, my second sock for the year out of my goal of 12 is a massive pair of hand-spun socks for my husband and his size 13.5 feet. This is hand-spun. It is Hello Yarn Corriedale in But the Tree Glowed. This is yarn that I spun, I don't even remember when I spun it, but out of one of those 5 patchwork kits that I mentioned in the other section, I found another bump of this of about 1 ounce more. So I was able to make a big 5 and some ounces cake. It was 162 grams when I weighed it. I am down to about 100 grams left in the cake, and I'm getting ready to start with the ribbing on the first sock. So the last time you guys saw it, I was about here-ish. I think I had just gotten to about this section, and I was getting ready to put in the heel. Well, since then, I have knit the entire foot of the sock to the heel. As you can see, my husband's feet are very big. They are taller than my head. My husband's whole foot up to where the heel goes in is actually as long as my entire foot with my heel. So, and then I could talk about that too. Because he has such a deep instep, and I was talking about this last time, I actually put in 4 sets of extra increases on the bottom to make sure that I had extra rows to get more row height or vertical height here in the short row section for the heel. I then proceeded to take those back out on the back of the leg. I took out, I think, 3 of the sets, and then eventually added 1 more of them back in. So I had 4 additional stitches in the leg than I did in the foot. So, toe up sock, fish lips kiss heel, because it's my favorite heel and it fits really well for both of us. And I'm now on to the leg, which is a lot taller than I was expecting. I really like how this hand spun is knitting up. It started off as more of a gradient,
And then you get up here and it becomes more of a distinct striping gradient. So I was kind of having a good laugh at how all over the place this yarn is. And you can kind of see here, there's lots of blues in with the green here. There's shots of aqua in here, but it's mostly oranges and greens. And overall it's pretty. And then you can see the spot where it should have, the gradient would have continued right here if it had been around the front. But yeah, it's a pretty good size so far, as you can see. If you fold it over on itself, the leg of the sock is almost as long as the foot at this point. And the plan is to get these as tall as possible. He told me that he does not care how tall they are as long as they are tall. He's been wanting taller socks for a while. My husband used to be a lower crew socks person only. Like, he doesn't like anklets. And he used to hate really tall socks, but he liked those mid-length, you know, crew socks that are like 4-inch legs, 5-inch legs. And because of the army and having to wear very tall socks all the time, he now is kind of fond of very tall socks. So he told me as tall as I can get these, and not running out of yarn, he will take. So I'm thinking I have another couple hours of knitting on this, because I'm going to, exactly in half would be 81 grams per sock. But of course, because it's hand spun, there's no guarantee that there's the exact same thickness of yarn and that it'll get me quite as far. So I'm going to, let's see, I'm at about 100 grams left in here. At about 95 grams, 97 grams, I'm going to start the ribbing. And then I'm going to cast off when I have about 83 grams left in the cake. That way there's just a little over half left to do the second sock, and hopefully that'll work out. So this has been something I put a lot of time into this week. I want to say I have probably put in close to a full day's worth of work hours on this at this point. There's probably a good 20 hours, almost 24 hours in this sock. It's definitely a labor of love, and it's very, very slow going. I knit on this thing almost all day yesterday, and I started about right here and I got to up here over the course of an entire day with lots and lots and lots of knitting. So that is making some progress. The next project I'm going to tell you about, I didn't show you last week, but it is my Find Your Fade shawl by Andrea Mowry, who is Dre Renee Knits, I think. You've probably seen this shawl just about everywhere at this point, because I think almost everyone has knit one. I'm a little late to the game because I decided to finish some other things first, and then I decided to do one with a bunch of partials of really rich brown, purple, red, caramel, and gold tones. So the last time you saw this, about a month ago, I was at this marker right here and I had knit this much of my fade. I was just transitioning from this Becoming Art MCN blend, which was Told You Would, and then I was going into this yarn, which is the only non-MCN blend in here. It's a 100% superwash merino 2-ply from Pigeon Roof Studios called Ophelia. And I think it was like a one-of-a-kind thingy. She names her one-of-a-kinds. So since then, I've been getting a little bit busy. Once I finished that sweater, I took off on this because this was my carrot to get that sweater done. Let's see if I can get this good and non-washed out. So I ended up knitting a lot of that Ophelia because it was a much bigger cake and some of my partials are very small. And I knit it through this lace section. And then I started transitioning into this purpley red yarn, which is coming off a little bit more red on camera. It should be a little bit more purple. It's more of like a raisin almost, a bright raisin color. And this one is from Politically Incorrect Fibers. I don't think she's dyed in a very long time, but this was a colorway. Oh gosh, let me think if I can remember it. It's OMG WTF LOL. And it's this beautiful, it's caramel tones, it's reds, it's purples. It reminds me somewhat of Sundara Yarns, Arabian Nights colorway. It's got some kind of figgy tones in it. This was a very small skein. So at this point in the pattern, I modified it. I did one less repeat of the mesh lace because I just didn't have enough to do the transition into my next color, which I have just, you know, started to blend into. You can see that some of these stripes are very dark and some of them are that red color, or that purpley red color. And now it's a very reddish brown. And this is a very small remnant of Mama Blue Troika Sock in the Pit colorway, which has a lot of red in it. Sorry, I have children knocking at my door now because it's after school. So from the Mama Blue, I'm now going to transition into this colorway, which is another politically incorrect fibers in the Mrs. Robinson colorway. And then after Mrs. Robinson, this last skein of Becoming Art, this one is Agave Fingering 70-20-10 Merino Cashmere Nylon in the Cherry Tart colorway, which is also part of that Alice in Wonderland. And I think it's going to be very pretty. Hopefully by the time this gets into the shawl, it'll be nice and it'll be at the widest point, and hopefully there won't be too much pooling. I have fallen way out of love with variegated yarns as in my time as a knitter. Like when I started off knitting in 2007, my 10-year knitting anniversary will be in May, right around the time of my son's birthday. Variegateds were the everything at that point. This was the heyday and the height of the Blue Moon Fiber Arts reign. And sorry, my girls are making more noise and I'm just trying to make sure they're not getting into trouble. This was the height of Blue Moon Fiber Arts popularity. This was a time when super variegated yarn, clown barf yarn, was super popular. It was everywhere and it was everything and everyone loved it. And you know, some of you really love your pooling and that's totally fine. If you love your pooling and your flashing and your big lakes of color, more power to you. It's just not for me. And I was very glad when tonals and semi-solids came in to take over from there, where Sundara and Madeline Tosh kind of came in to be the reigning queens of the most popular yarn for a while. And now we're in the heyday of, and then it was self-striping, and now we are in the heyday of speckles. And I'm very interested to see where we will go after speckles.
Tala, this is not the time.
You're gonna hear weird dog noises. Lucky you guys. So anyway, I'm hoping that this variegated skein won't be too bad because it's gorgeous and I love the colors in it. I'm afraid it's going to break my heart. And that's going to be the most disappointing thing. I think this base is probably the same base that is the Bugga base. So it's super, super soft. I wish I could figure out where they sourced this from because I've always looked for it and can never find it. But these two dyers for sure carry it. So there you go. That's it for my works in progress. I actually got a lot of knitting done in the last 2 weeks. I've been very pleased with it. On top of using the sweater or the Find Your Fade as a carrot to finish my sweater, I used a spinning project as a carrot to finish up through the heel of my husband's sock, because for me, the worst part of socks are the toe and the heels. I love a fish lips kiss heel. It's super easy, but when you're working it over, well, it's half of 78 stitches, so 39 stitches I think I was working it on, and you're working it at such a tight gauge, it takes forever. And so as incentive, I decided to finally spin up a braid of fiber that had been sitting by my wheel for about 3 months ready to go, and I just could not find the time to spin. I have been spinning, my lack of spinning, more appropriately, has been more due to trying to get through other projects first, because once I start spinning, all I want to do is spin, which is why I really love weeks like Spinzilla or like Tour de Fleece, where the objective is to spin as much as possible, because I can be down with 6 hours a day, all day spinning for a week on end. And I had decided that what I really wanted to do was spin some more sock yarn for my husband, which usually I try to aim for at least a sport weight for my husband. Sometimes if it's a lighter worsted weight, especially if it's a squishier yarn, it can work too. And I had pulled an older braid of back from when I was in the Moon Rover Fiber Club, the July 2014 colorway, and the Fiber Club was an 85% superwash merino, 15% nylon blend. It drafts like a dream. I had forgotten how nicely it drafts, and having a nicer spinner now, I suddenly don't hate merino as much as I used to. It's actually quite a bit more enjoyable to spin these days. But I decided to spin a traditional three-ply because I don't spin too many of those, and I remember I was talking to Kate, and we were discussing traditional three plies versus chain plies versus some other things. And unlike a lot of my other spinning counterparts, I don't have problems with my chain plies where you can feel the little, the bumps or the knots where you pull the loops through. That's never been noticeable in my yarn. So I'm not sure what I'm doing differently than a lot of other people are, but mine doesn't usually have bumps. And I usually prefer to blend the striping. However, the big downside to a chain plied yarn versus a traditional three ply is that if your yarn is thick and thin at all, the thick parts are going to make even thicker yarn because it, you know, it's plied back up on itself. And the thin parts are going to be extra thin compared to the rest of the yarn. So it can be a very, very inconsistent yarn, where a traditional three ply will for the most part even itself out, and those inconsistencies will be not nearly as bad. So this was a really pretty braid that was full of blues, golds, darker brown golds, and some pops of purple. And my husband is not super picky about yarn. He just wants socks. I mean, like, this is what he wants all the time. He's always asking me, he's like, when are you gonna knit me more socks? I need more socks, Amanda. Where are my socks? And he has been spoiled. He has all hand-spun socks. He has more hand-spun socks than I do, you guys. I think I have two pairs at this point. No, I think I just finished. I have three now. I have three pairs of hand-spun socks, and he has four, and enough yarn to knit him two or three more pairs. And in my sock club this year, my personal sock club, there's at least one more yarn that was pulled for personal or for hand-spun socks for him. But I know it's a thicker yarn that I had spun that didn't turn out as well as I would have liked. It was, I think it was Perindale or some other fiber that I wasn't very familiar with. It did not turn out as nicely as I would have wanted. It's very thick, and I think it's gonna make very short socks, so I'm gonna have to do some contrast heels and toes. But they should knit up fast. But anyway, so I did a custom three, or a traditional three-ply for him. What I have left of it is this little portion of a cake. These are my singles that are left over. I ended up spinning it where plies one and two were all connected together, but on a single bobbin. I do not have four bobbins to do a traditional three-ply. I have three bobbins. So plies one and two went together, and then I put them into a center pole ball, and I plied from the inside and the outside for the first two plies. So I went all through the entirety of color one first, and then attached color two and spun all the way through that. And I did it in such a way that colors one and two, colors that were similar, blended together in case they got down to it and they had to suddenly switch roles, so to speak. And then I spun the third ply by itself, and then I took these off of the bobbin and then used that same bobbin. Anyway, so there's about, I'd say about a quarter of an ounce of singles left there. What I ended up with was a 4.6, almost 4.7 ounce skein. There's approximately 270 yards in here of light worsted weight three ply. And it turned out super pretty. I'm really happy with how this turned out. You can see the sections here where there's those little bits of purple, but I was really pleased how often colors that complement each other ended up together. And you can kind of see there that it's a beautiful, really round yarn. It's very soft. I didn't overply it or overspin it at all. I'm very proud of myself. In the past, with my old spinner, when I had to fight with it, I always overspun merino, and I hated merino so much. But it's turned out really, really well. And actually, the colors are coming out a little bit more washed out on screen here, but they remind me a lot of a Van Gogh painting. Like, if you did, like, the sunflowers painting but took the greens out, it's those same kind of really rich golds and blues. And, yeah, it reminds me so much of a Van Gogh or a Van Gogh, however you want to pronounce it. So anyway, super happy with this. It's very squishy. I'm still going to do contrast heels, toes, and cuffs on these. I have some yarns that are in roughly the same weight that I think could work really well for this. And they don't have to totally match because, I mean, he only wears these in the house. It's not a big deal. And you can see the string I tied off with here. I've got it tied off in four places to make sure it doesn't tangle. But yeah, it turned out really well. And now I want to spin two or three more braids pretty soon here and do them the exact same way and see if I can't get better about getting that third ply to be long enough that I don't have any leftovers left, and also to maybe spin just the tiniest bit thinner and end up with something more that's a heavy sport weight, light DK weight, rather than a light worsted weight, because I had been really hoping to get about 300, 320 yards out of this, and I got 270, which was actually better than I thought it was going to be for a while, because just looking at the singles at one point, I was like, this is going to be a chunky weight yarn. I'm going to end up with like 200 yards of yarn and I can't use it for this. I was wrong. When I started plying, I realized it was a lot thinner. So this is my first spinning since October and I'm really happy with it. It's very squishy. After I washed it, when you pull it out, it does spring back on itself a little bit. So I lost a little bit of yardage to poofing up. But in my experience, and it wasn't a super big amount of spring, I lost maybe 5 yards out of this, so I'm calling it 270 and not worrying about it. And one last look at that.
So, now I have told myself that once I finish my husband's next sock, I am allowed to start another spin. And that yarn actually took me only 4 days of spinning about 2 hours a day to get it done. It drafted like an absolute dream. Lacey's fiber is delightful. And if you have an opportunity to spin some of it, you definitely should. I still have a partial bin with what was left of when I was in the club. I was in her club for a little over a year, maybe 15 months, I think, and I just got such a glut of fiber that I had to drop the club, even though I really didn't want to. So I pulled all the rest of my fiber clubs out. I can't remember if I had 6 or 7 left, and I picked the fiber clubs specifically because they're bigger braids. They're not standard 4-ounce braids, they're 5-ounce braids, or 5 ounces, give or take. And I picked them out, and my husband picked out 2 that he said he would want to see as socks. So I'm going to spin up either the September 2014, which is, I can't take it out easily, it's all taped shut. It's more purples, greens, this bright sky blue, gold, and there's kind of a sage green in here, and there's little hits of brown. It's different greens and all sorts of pretty colors. At whatever point this came in, if you go back to my September 2014 podcasts, you should be able to see this in person when I showed it off as a whole braid. And the other one he really liked, it doesn't seem like it was that long ago that I was in the club, but it is, was the February 2014 colorway, which this was when she was using cute tape. And this one is bright acid green, dark olive green, this kind of brick red, tan, teal, darker, not the same green as the army green. This is more of like a forest green, bright yellows, orange yellow, gray, brown, and more of a darker blue or teal at the end. And this one also caught his eye. This one might be a little tricky to spin. It might end up looking like a hot mess, but I think this one is gonna look pretty cohesive. I would like to spin them the same way. And what I ended up doing with these, actually I'm gonna break this open for just a second. Sorry guys, whoever had earbuds in, I really didn't mean to do that to you. And what I did, and see, you can see all the colors here now. Look at those colors. Isn't that so much better than seeing it in the bag? Is what I did is I unbraided the whole thing, and then I took it and I broke it into 3 approximately even sections vertically. So I played around with it, and when it's unbraided, it's very long. Like, I had to use the entire length of my living room and get my dogs off it and vacuum it and to lay them out to get roughly what I needed. And then I break it into approximately 3 equal sections. So I would do this, and I would break it off here and break it off in the other place. And then what I did is I did actually a fractal spin with the 3-ply. And because these color runs are so long, I knew that they were gonna make bigger, thicker stripes, which is just fine. What I did is the first ply, so like let's just say this is the first section here, I took it and I split it into 4 roughly even pieces. So I split it in half, and I split each of those in half again, and then I spun them one right after another. 1, 2, 3, 4. With that yarn, instead of doing what I normally do, where I like to work from 2 ends of the ball, with my husband's socks, I tend to knit them one at a time. So I spun them all in the same order, all 4, instead of trying to get them to go the opposite way and then knit from both ends at the same time. Then I took the second ply, and let's just say it's this, and I took it and I broke it into half and then 3 pieces each after that. So I had 6 pieces. So they were slightly shorter color runs than the first ply. And then I took the last ply and I broke it up and I split it in half, and I split each of those halves in half, and then I split them in half again. So I had 8 roughly equal thin pieces, so that there were certain blips of color that go through really, really fast rather than shorter. So what it'll do is it'll make it look a lot like fractal spun 2-ply socks, where the color shifts. There's that subtle striping rather than really stark striping, and they'll kind of shift and gradate between each other as they go along and you knit them. It should be a really pretty, really marbled effect. Gosh, look at that. Now I'm like super in love with this color because it's so much prettier. Like, even me looking at it in the bag, it didn't look this pretty. We'll have this fiber with us for a second. Or maybe not, because it's actually very warm. Okay, no more being silly. So that has to go back in its bag.
So, guys, the last thing I wanted to mention is I had forgotten to talk to you about something last time. I have no new acquisitions that I can think of. I ordered a new needle for my Find Your Fade shawl because all I had, I'm knitting those on Knitter's Pride marbles, and I had only a 32-inch needle, and that's way too short for this longest section to get a really good idea of how wide it is. So I ordered a new one, and I ordered the biggest size I could find, which was a 47-inch. So that's coming tomorrow, but I mean, that's like the only thing I'm going to definitely have coming in. Right now I'm trying very hard to not buy craft supplies and work through what I have, which is very difficult to do. But what I had forgotten to mention last time is that I had been gifted a pattern. Some of you, and actually a lot of you, probably know Sarah, who is the Naughty Gnome. Sarah has a delightful podcast that she does about once a month, and I saw a new episode just went up today, and I haven't had a chance to watch it yet, but I'm getting ready to do that maybe tonight. And she has a new pattern out. Sarah writes quilt patterns and knitting patterns and crochet patterns. She is just a little crafty machine, and she does all sorts of patterning and stuff. And she did a new pattern that she did in conjunction with a friend of hers who dyes yarn, and it's called the Cape Cod Socks. I'm going to show you a picture of it out of her pattern sample so that you can get an idea of what it looks like. But you can see it has a beautiful, interesting basket weave kind of a pattern on it. And I had seen her knitting these socks previously a while ago on one of her podcasts and mentioned that I loved the texture and asked her if she'd be writing a pattern. And at that time, she didn't think so. And I don't think she had written it down at all. So she didn't really know what she had done. She just remembered, you know, she just kind of winged it. Well, anyway, about a month ago, Sarah sent me a gift, and it was a pattern of this. It was a copy of the sock pattern, which is the Cape Cod Socks. It is a $4 downloadable pattern. It is from Knot A Gnome, and it comes in 5 sizes. And I think it goes from a child's size, large maybe, up through adult sizing. But I know there's at least one children's size in there. And then there's an adult small, medium, large, and I think maybe an extra large. I should have done a better job of checking that. Right now, if you are a member of her group and you watch her podcast, she has a knit-along going on for these socks. I haven't had a chance to go over there and check that out yet, but I noticed on the pattern page there was a note about it, and it's going through the 31st of this month. So if you are a fast sock knitter and you're looking for a new textured pattern to knit, it might be a good choice. As of right now, there's 12 finished objects in there, and 2 of them are hers, which are her samples. But there was a pair that's in self-striping, which actually is what I was thinking about knitting this pattern in for sure, because I like knitting textured knits in self-striping yarn because it adds just a little bit of interest to them. That face is because I realized I have an example of this down here. So another example of this, because I enjoy doing this, is I had knit the Blueberry Waffle sock pattern, which is a free pattern. And I'm suddenly spacing on who did that one, but it's one that, again, almost everybody has and their mother has knit. And I did it in Knit Picks Felici Sport. As you can see, textured patterns play together really, really well with self-striping yarn. And when it comes to socks and non-hand-spun socks, self-striping yarn, self-patterning yarn are still my bays. I love them. I will probably love them forever. I love me stripey socks. I can take variegated or speckled as long as they don't pool, but yeah, I've gotten rid of most of my variegated socks at this point, and I'm not sad for that. So anyway, I was planning to knit that sock at least one time, that texture, into at least one pair of self-striping socks. So Sarah, once again, thank you for that gift, and I'm sorry that I forgot to mention it last time I talked to everybody. And with that, guys, I think we are to the end of the podcast. Like I said, there isn't a lot going on in my life right now that was not scrambling around trying to get my husband ready to go and trying to get my family prepared for my husband to be gone. He's currently, like I said, in holding. I don't know if he's on his way to the main airport yet or not, but he would not be flying out of here. We have an international airport. It says it's international, but it's definitely not. It's a little rinky-dink regional airport that usually you hop a little flight to someplace pretty close. It might have, I think there's like one service that it flies out. There's like one air hub for one airline that might go to a couple bigger airports outside of the state, but mostly it's you fly from Watertown to Syracuse and then you take your real flight from Syracuse. And so I think they're flying out of Syracuse today. I didn't even think to ask. But I would imagine he's probably going out of LaGuardia, actually, because he's going overseas. Anyway, he should be going out. I know his flight is tonight, and he was a little bummed that they are making him leave early because he could have spent today napping because he's not going to fly or he's not going to sleep on the flight. So he's going to be up since pretty early this morning. He's going to be on an overnight flight international, probably not sleeping, and then he's going to get there and he's going to have to work right away. He's told me he might not be able to get back to me for the first day or two that he's there because they have so many things planned, including a battalion run the next morning. Yeah, I feel really bad for all those guys, actually, that they're getting stuck doing that, because who wants to go on like a 5-mile run after you've just taken an international flight the day before and you probably didn't sleep very well? I think that's downright mean. But so for me, so far I'm fine. We didn't get to do much on our anniversary, which is fine because I wasn't even expecting him to be home at all. So we spent the day running errands and included grocery shopping. I ended up making fancier homemade pizza. We did a steak and roasted broccoli pizza. I ended up making homemade funfetti cupcakes with funfetti frosting. We rented Trolls from the Red Box, which just came out yesterday. We decided we'd watch a fun movie with our kids, and the funfetti worked really well with the Trolls. Those two decisions were made independently of each other, but serendipitous, they matched up really well, so we had these super fun rainbow cupcakes to eat with this really colorful, fun movie. It's a cute movie. It's not my favorite kids' movie, but I really loved the music choices in that movie. If you love like 70s and 80s and a little bit of like 90s pop, that was a fun movie, having how they integrated it into everything. And sometimes I recognized songs before my husband did because they aren't so much his genre of music, but I know most of them because I grew up listening to the oldies stations, and anyone who has an adult in their life who listens to easy listening will have recognized most of them, but like Lionel Richie's Hello is in there, Cyndi Lauper's True Colors is in there, and it's a lot of fun, and it's such an interesting choice of how to work those in. So it, as far as it goes, it worked for a movie based off of silly little troll doll toys from the 70s. It was a little slow to start, though. My husband and I both agreed that the first 20 minutes or so of the film were kind of but then once the plot got going, it was okay. And it ended all right, too. I think they could have put a little less into the beginning of the movie and a little bit more effort into winding up the movie and having the resolution make maybe a little bit more sense. But I think I had these same complaints about the second Hotel Transylvania movie, where there was a lot of time wasted on... you could tell there must have previously been a different plot line and they changed it at the last minute. And I tend to feel very strongly that if you're going to do a major change like that, you may as well just take the time and rewrite the whole movie correctly and then do it from there. I'll get off my soapbox because they're kids' movies. I guess I'm overthinking them. You might be able to hear the trumpets playing. That means my children will be coming back in about 2 or 3 minutes. So let's wrap this up. So anyway, that's all we really did. I'm going to be doing a lot of crafting. I'm going to be trying to establish a routine, although I am a person who never has had a routine in her life. I am extreme. I've described myself before as chaotic. I'm very chaotic. I'm very free-spirited. You can't tell me what to do. I can't tell me what to do. But I'm going to try to get into some routines that will hopefully make my life a little bit easier. My husband has always been the person who does all the dishes, for example. We have a policy of I cook, he cleans up afterwards, because he doesn't want to cook and he doesn't like to cook when he does cook. So I do all the cooking, and we have firehouse rules where a person who cooks doesn't have to clean up. So normally he does all the dishes and stuff, and now I have to start doing all my own dishes, which that's possibly my least favorite chore ever. So I got to start thinking about how I'm going to get that stuff done every night and just make myself do it, because adulting. And now I'm just rambling, and I'm sorry about that, guys. I'm going to let you go. If this was your first podcast, I'm sorry. I'm usually a little more put together than this, and I usually have a slightly better location where you're not looking at an odd angle and you're looking at like one of our smoke alarms here. Or is that the CO2 detector? That might be a CO2 detector. and you can see like some of my, her name is Emily. I mean, she's the black apple, I think. She has some children's books, different art prints there. And yeah, we're just at a weird angle in general because you guys are on top of some boxes with my iPhone on a stand on it. Thank you to everyone who had the nice comments about my dogs, by the way. I appreciate that you all appreciated seeing my dogs. I took a segment from earlier in the podcast when they were bothering me and stuck it at the end just because it seemed like a good place to put it. And now I'm umming a lot and you can hear my daughter's back because she's singing. So anyway, guys, I'm going to go. Hello again.
Hello.
Did you have a good time playing outside? That's good. Okay. We are going to say goodbye to the kittens, and we will talk to them in a couple of weeks.
Bye.
All right, kittens.
Bye-bye.
So, as I always say, please be your very best selves and do good things. And I will talk to you in about 2 weeks. Bye.